Hariyom, does anybody want to chant the Dhyana Shloka? I don't see anybody's hands raised. Okay. Okay. Start. Parthaya Pratibodhitam Bhagavata Narayanena Swayam Vyasena Gratitam Purana Munina Madhye Mahabharatam Advaitamrita Varshinim भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीं अम्ब त्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवत् गीते भवद्वेषिणीं नमोऽस्तु ते व्यासविशालबुद्धे पुल्लारविन्दाय तपत्रनेत्र येन त्वया भारततैलपूर्णः प्रज्वालितो ज्ञानमयप्रदीपः प्रपन्नपारिजाताय स्तोत्रवेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः सर्वोपनिषदो गावो दुग्धा गोपालनन्दनः पार्थो वत्स सुधीर्भोक्ता दुग्धं गीतामृतं महत् वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानन्दं कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुम् भीष्मद्रोणतटा जयद्रथजला गान्धारनीलोत्पला शल्यग्राहवती कृपेण वहनी कर्णेन वेलाकुला अश्वत्थामविकर्णघोरमकरा दुर्योधनावर्तिनी सोधीर्णा खलु पाण्डवैरणनदी कैवर्तकःकेशवः पाराशरीयवचः सरोजममलं गीतार्थगन्धोत्कटं नानाख्यानकेसरं हरिकथा सम्बोधनाबोधितं लोके षड्जनषट्पदैरहरः पीपीयमानं मुदा भूयाद्भारतपङ्कजं कलिमल प्रध्वंसिनः श्रेयसे मूकं करोति वाचालं पङ्गुं लङ्घयते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे परमानन्दमाधवम् यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतः स्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनः यस्यान्तं न विदुःसुरासुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः Can you all hear me? I hope you can all hear me. Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. सदाशिव समारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तां वंदे गुरु परंपरां परं वरिष्ठं ब्रह्मिष्ठं परमानंदरूपिणं परमार्तानन्दयतिं सद्गुरुं प्रणतोऽस्म्यहम्। So Lord Krishna continues with his main theme of giving a list of vibhutis, the glorious expressions in the creation, both belonging to this world as well as the other world, and both religious as well as secular or non-religious list. Everything is covered in this list, right? So the list continues in the following shlokas. And as I said in the last class, some of these shlokas have a lot of references to Puranas, and wherever it is required and to the extent that, you know, I can deviate, I just spend a few seconds like my guru also does, right? So I'm trying to give you a little bit of background in case people are not aware, right? So we saw verse 30, which went Prahladaschasmi daityanam kalakalayatamaham mriganam cha mrigendroham vainateyascha pakshinam. That is what we saw. I am Prahlada among the daityas, I am time among the computers, I am the lion among animals, and Garuda, right, among the birds. This is what we saw. Continuing, Pavana Pavatamasmi, Pavana Pavatamasmi, Rama Shastra Vritamaham, Rama Shastra Vritamaham, Jashanam Makarashchasmi, Jashanam Makarashchasmi, Srotasamasmi Janavi, Srotasamasmi Janavi. Pavanaha Pavatamasmi, among all purifying agents, I am the wind or fresh air, right? We all know the importance of air, airing the room, right? When we have closed the room for a few days, you have a musty kind of smell, right? Nothing is as refreshing as fresh air inside a room, right? Not only it purifies the outside, it also purifies the inside. Our breath, our body, it rejuvenates the body, it pumps fresh air, it puts in oxygen, and through the blood it energizes the body, right? So it is not only the purifier of the external world, but also the purifier of the internal body also. So therefore Lord Krishna says, I am the wind among the purifiers, right? Punati iti pavanaha. Pu means to purify, right? So, and then he says, I'm not only pavanaha amongst the winds, I am also Ramaha amongst the people wielding weapons. Shastra Britamaham. Shastram means weapons. A weapon which is held in the hand and fought. Astram means that which is released. So in today's parlance, a missile would be called an astram, right? Among all the weapon wielders, I am the great Rama, whose glory as Kodandapani. Kodandapani is glorified in Ramayanam, right? How he single-handedly fought Kara, Dushana, all these various Ravanas that Rama fought. fought, right? All these are described. Therefore, Lord Krishna claims that I am Ramaha Kodanda Pani. And if you remember, Lord Shiva's bow is called Pinakam, and therefore he is called Pinaka Panihi, right? So Kodanda Panihi is Rama. So Shastra Britamaham. Now, if you notice, this is very interesting for Sanskrit students, the language students. The entire chapter 10 has so much of Shashti Vibhakti and Saptami Vibhakti. The reason being, we are saying I am so and so among so and so, right? So Shastra Britam Aham, right? Pavatam Aham. So that is the Shashti Vibhakti coming in. So amongst several, I am so and so. So every half pada of the verse has one Shashti Vibhakti, or in some cases, Lord Krishna has used the Saptami Vibhakti. Okay. Then Jashanam Makarashchashmi. Jashanam is aquatic creatures, right? Among the aquatic creatures, I am Makaraha, the biggest one. And Swamiji says the biggest one is what? The blue whale or something like that, right? Which is supposed to be very huge, right? So I am the big one, Makaraha. Shrotasam asmi Janavi. I am Ganga among the rivers, right? So in the Puranas, always two stories are very prominent, as we discussed even in the last class, I think. Right, one is the Samudra Mathanam, which is a very big story, and which we saw in the last class. And another equally great story is Ganga Avataranam. Ganga Devi is considered to be a celestial river which has been brought by Bhagiratha for a particular purpose. In fact, that's why Ganga's name is Bhagirathi also, right? It's a very big story, and it is said that Bhagiratha's ancestors got burnt to ashes by Rishi Kapila because his tapas was disturbed by them. They all turned to ashes, and as progeny, these people wanted, Bhagiratha wanted to save them, right? Save his ancestors. And they come to know, all several of his ancestors tried. They all came to know that only Ganga river can save them, but Ganga is not here and in heaven. Therefore, for several generations they tried, right? How can the celestial river be brought to the earth, right? So, Bhagiratha is known for his determination and perseverance. So, crossing over all the obstacles, right? First, he prayed to Ganga Devi to come down. First, Ganga Devi has to accept, because coming to earth for Ganga is a painful thing, because there will be Rakshasas, all kinds of people, humanity, etc., right? So, a lot of papam she has to taken into the Ganges, the purifier, right? Therefore, Bhagiratha does tapas to Ganga Devi, inviting her down. After a lot of tapas, Ganga Devi accepts, but asks the question, if I come down with the full force from the height, the earth cannot withstand, right? It will be like a meteorite hitting. It can even destroy the earth. So again, Bhagiratha had to solve this problem. So what he did was, he did tapas and went to Lord Shiva, and Lord Shiva decided to receive the Ganges. Ganga Devi had so much pride that she was wondering whether Lord Shiva will be able to receive. She was so arrogant, right? Garvaha. So she came with all the force, and Lord Shiva did not even look at her. He was continuing with his tapas, and when she came down, he had a long jada, and he just opened only a part of the jada, and the whole Ganges was contained within his jada. So Ganga Devi's Garva Bhanga happened in one moment, right? Unfortunately, Shiva forgot the original purpose of Bhagiratha. So Ganga is in jada, and he went into tapas, and Bhagiratha was waiting, right? Then again, he had to request Lord Shiva, and Lord Shiva brought Ganga, not the full one, only a small portion. That is the Ganga Devi that we have, right? There also the problem was not over. When the Ganga was flowing, it just flowed through the ashrams that came in between, the Rishis ashrams, right? Even now you can see in the Himalayas, several ashrams get flooded when Ganga flows in spate, right? So Jannu Maharishi, he got disturbed, and therefore he got wild, right? So what happened was, he just swallowed Achamanam, right? The whole river was gone inside the inside Jannu Maharishi. Again, Bhagiratha is waiting. Again, he went to Jannu Maharishi and prayed. And Jannu released the Ganga through the ear. And therefore, Ganga Devi got the name Jahnavi. Right? So, basically, Jahnavi here refers to Ganges. Right? Once your goal is big and you remember the goal all the time, all the obstacles appear small. Right? So, Bhagiratha had exactly that. And he exactly like Anjaneya, right, who had to cross the ocean, right? For Anjaneya, the ocean became a very small thing, right? There is a very beautiful shloka, right, in Hanuman Stuti. Goshpadi krita varisham mashaki krita rakshasam Ramayana Mahamala Ratnam Vande Anilatmajam. I pray to him who is born to the god of wind, who made the king of lakes, that's the ocean, look like a hoof of a cow, who made the great rakshasas look like simple mosquitoes whom we just swat, right? And to whom I pray to him who is born to the god of wind, right? And he is the great jewel in the great garland of the story of Rama, right? So when Anjaneya remembered Rama and his mission to cross the ocean, right, it became a small pool of water. And what is the size of the pool? Goshpada. When a cow walks on the mud, the cow hoof mark is there, right? Just that size, right? So for Anjaneya, the Samudra became a small pool of water, right? So, and therefore, the reason why Swamiji gave this example is that however big your goal is, if you are fixed on attaining that, all the obstacles can be removed due to Ishwara Kripa, or some way will open up for you through that and you can achieve the goal, right? So therefore, Shrota Samasmi Jahnavi. So all this story, I remember Swamiji saying, in order to explain the name Jahnavi and how Bhagiratha brought Ganga to earth, and therefore through the Maharishi got this name Jahnavi. And here Krishna says, I am that Jahnavi, right? And Kapila Muni was actually doing tapas in the Patalam, right? And they say some interesting story about this, right? What happened was Kanchi Paramacharya, he used to give talks, and those talks have been captured in the form of a book called Daivatin Kural. It's been translated even into English. Right? And when Kapila Muni was doing tapas in Patalam, I believe there was a place called Kapila Aranyam, right? Kapila Aranyam. So actually Paramacharya used to say that is what became California, right? And he makes an observation, and people in the US can confirm. He says there's an island nearby called Ash Island. It was called Ash Island, right? And we read from the Puranic story that all of the ancestors of Bhagiratha were in the form of ash because they were burnt down, right? So this is an interesting story about Jahnavi. Let's continue. Sarga namadirantascha, sarga namadirantascha, madhyam chaivaham Arjuna. Madhyam chaivaham Arjuna adhyatma vidya vidyanam adhyatma vidya vidyanam vada pravadatamaham vada pravadatamaham. Sarganam adirantascha, the entire creation I am, aham, Adihi Madhyama Antascha, right? Beginning, middle, and end, right? So you can take it spatially, you can take it time-wise also. One commentator makes a very nice observation, right? How thorough they have been in the study, we can appreciate from this. They never look at anything superficially. Lord Krishna has said the same idea before in the 20th verse, right? We may forget, in the 20th verse, Krishna said, Ahamatma Gudakesha Sarvabhutashaya Sthitaha. So the commentator carefully remembers here, right? And he said, Ahamadishcha Madhyancha Bhutanam Anteyevacha. Right? So, why does Krishna repeat the same thing again? Right? So, the commentator says, no, no, there is no repetition dosha here. Lord Krishna did not commit this mistake and he will not. There the word used is Bhutanam. Here the word used is Sarganam. So, the word Bhutanam refers to the living beings. And there the creation is from the standpoint of Chetana Prapancha. Here it is from the standpoint of Achetana Prapancha, the total creation. Therefore, in short, Bhagavan is the beginning, middle and end of both Chetana and Achetana Prapancha. Right? So, next Lord Krishna brings in Adhyatma Vidya Vidyanam. Among all the branches of science, which are the materialistic sciences of the world, dealing with several parts of this creation, I am the only science which deals with not matter, but the spirit, the Atma. All the other sciences are Anatma Vidya, and Anatma Vidya means dealing with Anatma, the changing world, right? So, whether it is dealing with a micro level as atom or macro level like galaxy or the cosmos, they all come under material world only. So, in the seventh chapter, what we saw as matter is apara prakriti and atmatattvam is para prakriti, right? The reality, Brahman. So, adhyatma vidya means spiritual knowledge, right? So, the glory of spiritual knowledge can be discussed for several hours, right? We can take just one aspect and then we just take one aspect, any branch of science, right? You take each one of them will make us feel smaller and smaller. Whatever we study, we will always feel that there is so much left to study, right? But even if you take land, if you say study about the, you know, one, if you see sun, then there are so many other stars like the sun, right? If you study about earth, there are so many other planets like the earth, right? The galaxies, the continents, all of them, right? And we are so insignificant as compared to all these large things in the cosmos, right? And any of these branches is divided, and people do PhD for years and years, right? Whereas Adhyatma Vidya is the only one which tells you, you are not the dust particle or a small insignificant thing called the body, right? You are not just the small insignificant thing called the mind, right? But you are the Chaitanya Tattvam, which has got the seven features, the seven virtues that we saw earlier, Nityaha, Sarvagataha, Akarta, Abhokta, Stanuhu, etc. That Atma you are, which is so vast in size that all the galaxies are like bubbles coming and going in you, the Atma. So it makes you feel really, really big, right? So in Atma Bodha, verse 8, right? Upadane khiladare jaganti parameshware sargastiti layan yanti budbudaniva varini. Budbuda means bubbles. And Jnani says, all the galaxies are nothing but bubbles in me, right? I am infinite and not this small one, small body or mind, right? I am Purnamadaha, right? I am not the worthless one. I am the only worthy thing, right? So as they say in English, I am the salt of the earth, right? It's an idiom which means that it refers to a person who is simple, honest and worthy, a very good person, someone who is very, very genuine, right? So the only worthy thing is the Nama Rupa added on to me, which is basically everything else is Nama Rupa except me, the Satchidananda Atma, right? So, I, the Satchidananda Atma, is the worthy one, right? And Adhyatma Vidya is the only branch that helps me claim the infinite, right? Therefore, Lord Krishna says, Adhyatma Vidya Vidyanam, right? I am the Adhyatma Vidya. Next, Lord Krishna claims, Vadaha Pravadatamaham, right? Among the varieties of discussions, right? Our tradition has classified varieties of discussions, right? Based on, you know, the kind of discussions are there, right? So we have many types. One is called Vadaha, right? The second is called Jalpaha. The third one is called Vidanda. In our houses, you would have heard, Vidanda, in Tamil we say Vidanda Vadam Pannada, Vidanda, right? Jalpaha, Vadaha and Vidanda, right? So Vada means where both the people involved in discussion have got an open mind and they want to discover which particular view is right or wrong. Oh, openness is there, right? Open-mindedness. And therefore, I listen to the other person. This is called Vadaha, right? Where you will have a result of Tattva Nirnaya. You will be able to essentially uncover the truth, right? Because you are open to each other's viewpoints. The second one is the egocentric argument that is called Vidanda. Vidanda is the egocentric argument, right? So whatever suggestion you give, it has not worked. Just because you said it will not work, right? That is Vidanda, destructive attitude. The third one is called Jalpaha, which is used in philosophical systems, right? In darshanams, they use the Jalpa for reinforcing knowledge, right? Now, I cannot answer any question raised by other people, right? If I am not convinced, right, about the teaching. Therefore, to strengthen that knowledge, right, they will have advanced manana granthas where questions will be raised and the answers will be given, right? So if Vedanta is a darshanam, so many other systems will keep raising questions as purva paksha. So my knowledge has to be dridagnyanam, right? For that purpose, we use Jalpaha, right? So establishing a particular view by refuting all other counterviews is Jalpaha, right? So Parapaksha Nirakarana Purvaha Swapaksha Sthapanam. So that is, and getting Jnana Nishta by refuting other philosophies or darshanam is Jalpaha, right? So the mananam process is the Jalpa process, right? So Lord Krishna says, among all the three, I am Vada, in which there is open discussion, right? So I believe Swami Chinmayanandaji used to say, light should be generated and not heat. In a destructive discussion, only heat is generated, right? Continuing. Somebody is saying no audio. Can you just check that sometime back? Anyway. Aksharanamakarosmi. Aksharanamakarosmi. Dvandvasamasikasyacha. Dvandvasamasikasyacha. Ahamevakshayakkalaha. Ahamevakshayakkalaha. Dataham Vishvato Mukaha. Dataham Vishvato Mukaha. Now, continuing in the 33rd shloka, Lord Krishna says, Aksharanam Akarosmi. Previously, if you remember, he said, among the words I am Omkaraha, right? So, Omkaraha is taken in the list of words, but now Lord Krishna says the list of alphabetical letters, right? So Lord Krishna says, I am Akara, Akara Asmi, which is the primal or foremost and beginning alphabetic letter in all the Indian languages, right? While discussing Omkara also, Swamiji says English alphabet is a very peculiar alphabet A, right? You don't have, even amongst the 26 letters, you don't have A. That is why whenever we want to have A, you use different spellings, right? You say C-U-T, cut, right? You say B-U-T, but then we use different, you use the letter U to represent A, right? Therefore, A itself is missing in that, in the English alphabets. And that's the most, the fundamental sound, which alone gets modified to all letters. So the basic sound, right, the upadana karanam is akara, like a lump of clay, right? And therefore, A is called the karana A. is called, you should actually say a. A is the Karana Aksharam, and all others are formed by making faces thereafter, right? Ooh, etc. Right? So you just open your mouth and close your mouth, etc. So therefore, Veda says, A being the Karana Aksharam and all other letters being the Karyam, right? Karanam alone is in the form of all Karyam. Therefore, Veda makes a statement, Akarovai Sarvavak. All the words and sentences are nothing but made up of so many alphabetical letters, which are all modified forms of the basic sound Akara only. That is why in our tradition, we have presiding deities for all the alphabetic letters also. And the presiding deity for Akara is Brahma, the creator, right? Just as from Brahma, the entire creation comes, similarly from Akara alone, the entire Shabda Prapancha comes. And therefore, Lord Krishna says, I am that basic letter among all the letters. It is like the white color, which is the cause of all the seven colors. Similarly, A is the Moolam, which expresses in the form of all other letters. Therefore, I am Akara. Okay. Next, I'm going to explain a little bit of Sanskrit grammar here. Those who are Sanskrit experts or who are exposed to Sanskritam, please bear with me a few minutes because I need to explain this in order to explain the shloka itself. Okay. So the next one Krishna says is Dvandvah Samasikasya cha, right? In Sanskrit grammar, we can form compound words where many words are combined together and it becomes a long compound word, right? So in English, we use hyphen, right? And in one compound word. Now you take Prapanna Parijataya. Now, I hope you remember that we chant this as part of Dhyana Shloka, right? So that's why I chose this. Prapanna Parijataya, right? So that is a compound word, right? Which means unto one who is like a wish fulfilling tree for those who have surrendered. So Prapannanam, for those who have surrendered, Parijataha, wish fulfilling tree. Now it's combined, right? And it is called Prapanna Parijataha, right? Similarly, we have Totra Vetraika Panaye, right? So this is also combined together, right? In English also we have hyphenated compound words, right? For instance, take Ganga Jalam. What does it mean? It's water from the Ganges, right? Similarly, you can say turmeric powder, right? What is that? Powder of turmeric. Chili powder, powder of chili. Pepper powder, powder of pepper. When you say tooth powder, what do you say? You don't say powder of tooth. You say powder for the teeth, right? So when it is tooth powder, you say powder for the teeth, the same hyphen remaining, right? So another example Swamiji gives is Ram Mandir is a temple where Rama is worshipped. Krishna Mandir, Shiva Mandir, Devi Mandir, right? But then, suppose you say you extend it to Birla Mandir. It's absurd, right? It's a Mandir which is built by Birla. So, what should be added from the context, you should know, right? Basically, whether it is built by or whether it is for or of, etc., right? So, the other one is puncture shop, right? In India, we have this puncture shops, right? It's not a shop that creates punctures. It's a shop that repairs punctures, right? So similarly, headache pill. It's not a pill that causes headache, right? So we've got several types of compounds and Lord Krishna does not want to leave that subject also, right? So among various compounds, we have it's called samasa and it's called tatpurusha samasa, karmadaraya samasa, bahuvrihi samasa, dvandva samasa. So many are there, right? So Krishna says, I am dvandva samasa here, right? So I just tried to, this is just my own doing, I just tried to map the English compound words to the Sanskrit samasas God has to first forgive me for this, but I thought it might make more sense, so I put it here. So I said turmeric powder is Karmadharaya Samasa for people who do not know Sanskrit. Tooth powder is Tatpurusha Samasa because it is powder for the tooth. And old money, which is a compound word which is used for referring to someone who is rich because of inheritance. It is not referring to the money or the old. It is referring to someone who has received, is rich because of inheritance. So Bahuvrihi. This is called Bahuvrihi Samasa. In Sanskritam, Pitambaram, like the person who wears yellow dress, right? Krishna, Mahavishnu is referred to as, that is called Bahuvrihi Samasa, right? So old money is the nearest example that I could get in English. And Rama, Lakshmana, Shatrughna, Bharata. In English, you don't see such compound words. So it is referring to Rama and Lakshmana, Shatrughna and Bharata, all four of them together. Now, why does Krishna say that I am Dvandva Samasa? Several different commentators have given several reasons. The simple reason is, in all the other compounds, by now you would have seen, many words are there, but finally the words refer to only one person, right? Person or object, turmeric powder, tooth powder, right? Old money, etc., right? So it refers ultimately to one person, right? So, whereas in Dvandva Samasa, all the words that form the compound have equal importance and still stand out. So the Dvandva Samasa compound Rama Lakshmana Shatrughna Bharata refers to Rama Lakshmana Shatrughna Bharata, all four subjects, right? So therefore, so several commentators have given reasons as to why Krishna says this. I think this is the most logical reason, because this is the only samasa where there is equal importance to all the subcomponents of the samasa itself, right? So for instance, here Totra Vetrai Kapanaye, right? It means the handle of the see, if you read it verbatim, it talks as the handle of the whip, one hand, right? It doesn't make any sense. If you hyphenate it correctly, it's actually that Lord Krishna who has got the handle of the whip in one hand, right? So all these long sentences you can avoid in Sanskritam by having this simple one term, right? So that is the only reason. And to in Totra Vetrai Kapanaye, all these words refer to one person, that is Lord Krishna. Whereas in Dvandva Samasa, it refers to Rama, Lakshmana, Bharata, Shatrughna, all of them, right? So that is why it is called the Dvandva. And it is also, there is a sutra in the grammar which says Cha Arte Dvandvaha. So it is in the meaning of conjunction and, right? So the sense of conjunction, right? So therefore Krishna says, among samasas, I am Dvandva Samasa. Then Ahame Vakshayaha Kalaha, right? I alone am the time, a time which exhausts everyone. We get exhausted in time. We get old, right? It exhausts our memory, our everything gets exhausted, right? Money, right? Our own physique, everything. So during Pralaya Kalam also, everything gets resolved. But remember, time remains even in Pralaya in potential form functioning. How do you know time is functioning in Pralaya? If time is not functioning in potential form in Pralayam, then once the resolution happens, it will not end, right? And if Pralayam does not end, the next Srishti cannot come, right? So therefore, and the next Srishti has to come, then only the Sanchita Karma also can ripen and the next set of Prarabdha Karma can get ready, right? So Lord Krishna says, I am inexhaustible time, which exhausts everything. I am the inexhaustible time. Akshayaha Dataham. And as the time is ripening, all the karmas are also ripening. And I alone am the one who will allot the appropriate karma phalam to the appropriate person without mixing up. right? I don't mix up karma palams of one person and the other, right? So Lord Krishna says, I am the one who is in charge of distributing the karma palam, right? Karma phala adhyakshaha, dataham here, the dispenser, allotter, and vishvatomukaha means what? I've got a face in all directions, right? So I know exactly what you're doing where, right? Vishvatomukaha, face turned in all directions, and you can never hide anything from me. You cannot keep any secret away from God, right? Continuing. Mrityu sarvaharashchaham, mrityu sarvaharashchaham, udbhavashcha bhavishyatam, udbhavashcha bhavishyatam, kirti shrivakchanarinam, kirti shrivakchanarinam, smritir medha dhritikshamam, Smritir Medha Dhritikshama. Mrityu Sarvaharashchaham. Mrityu means Lord Death, who is the greatest or worst robber, who robs everything from a person, right? All the other robbers may take away your ornaments or your wealth or, you know, whatever. Whereas Yamadharma Raja not only robs everything, he takes away the mamakara, he robs away the very life, the body-mind complex itself. Body itself is robbed, right? Therefore, who is the remover of everything, right? So, there is another meaning also. We say that Bhagavan is Kala Tattvam, which exhausts or which removes everything. And Kala is what? Eternal. It continues all the time. So in this shloka, he says, Bhagavan is Kalasyapi Kalaha, the one who takes away the Kala Tattvam also, ultimate remover of, eliminator of Kala Tattvam also. So that's why in the Puranic stories, when Markandeya embraced Lord Shiva, right, Kala, Yamadharma Raja, who wanted to rob his life, then Yamadharma Raja himself was in a fix, right? Therefore, Lord is called Kalasya Kalaha. So, Kala removes everything. Bhagavan is remover of Kala Tattvam itself. And how does Bhagavan remove Kala Tattvam? Very interesting. By giving spiritual knowledge. A person, right? A Lord takes a person to Brahman, and that Brahman, which is beyond Desha and Kala. Therefore, Sarvaharaha, including Kalam, right? Sarvaharashaham. I can defeat the Kalaha also, right? That's what Krishna says here. Sarvaharaha cha aham, udbhavascha bhavishyatam. I am the source of all the future growth or prosperity also. Whatever prosperities have to come, that is also available in potential form. In Bhagavan alone, everything remains in potential form. Udbhavascha bhavishyatam, right? Then kirtihi shrivakcha narina, among women, right? I am Shri. A big list is given. When you look at the list, like you see various devatas representing a lot of noble and sacred things. Here many sacred things are listed here, right? So he says wealth is something that obviously Shri, right, is something that everyone values and prays for, right? So, wealth is personified as Sakshan Lakshmi Devi, Shri Devi, right? So, Lord Krishna says, among the women, I am all these goddesses. Which are the goddesses? Kirtihi, first one, fame, right? Then Shri. Shri represents Lakshmi Devi, wealth, importance, right? Then the speech capacity, right? Vak, right? So, the speech capacity or communication skills, right? Saraswati Devi, right? So that is why when we are children, we are asked to do these prayers, right? Because we need all of them, health, wealth, and wisdom. And then therefore, we also pray to Durga. Durga standing for health, Lakshmi standing for wealth, Saraswati standing for wisdom. And early morning, we are asked to offer the prayer to what? कराग्रे वसते लक्ष्मी, करमध्ये सरस्वती, करमूले स्थिता गौरी, राइट, प्रभाते कर दर्शनम, राइट, मे यू इन्वोक दी थ्री गॉडेसेस इन द हैंड. व्हाई? बिकॉज बाय इन्वोकिंग इन द हैंड्स व्हाट इज कन्वेड इज एवरीथिंग इज अवेलेबल इन योर ओन हैंड्स, अवर ओन हैंड्स. सो लाइंग डाउन इज नॉट इनफ. By invoking the goddesses in my hand, I am ready to start working for various aspects, right? So our effort to tap these three devatas, therefore, Vak stands for knowledge and speech. Then the next one is Smritihi. Very important. Smritihi means memory, to remember all that we are studying for the Medha Shakti itself. Dhritihi means willpower or the ability to focus, right? And Shama is patience or tolerance. We've also studied about Titiksha in Tattva Bodha, right? So Titiksha, endurance, ability to confront pain, ability to put up with emotional disturbances, right, etc. Right? That is Titiksha, right? So greater the tolerance, lesser the anxiety, right? So that is Titiksha or Shama, right? Continuing, Brihat Samatata Samnam, Brihat Samatata Samnam, Gayatri Chanda Samaham, Gayatri Chanda Samaham, Masanam Margashirshoham, Masanam Margashirshoham, ऋतूनां कुसुमाकरः, ऋतूनां कुसुमाकरः. सो बृहत् साम. सो प्रीवियस्ली लॉर्ड कृष्णा सेड आई एम द साम वेद अमंग ऑल द फोर वेदास. नाउ साम वेद इज फुल ऑफ मंत्रास. सो विच मंत्रा विल यू चूज? सो is choosing a particular mantra called Brihat Sama, right? So generally Samavedis, when they study this mantra first, right? So I don't know much of Samaveda, though of course I have been exposed to Samaveda. So they say this is the first mantra that comes there. Aho he comes, because Samaveda is musical, right? So Sama mantras are musicals, and Krishna here says I am the Brihat Sama among the Sama Mantram, right? And Gayatri Chandasam Aham, right? Gayatri Chandasam Aham, among the Vedic mantras in different meters, right? I am the Gayatri Mantra, which happens to be in the Gayatri meter also, right? So that particular meter of the Gayatri is Gayatri meter, right? And Gayatri has got three padas, three lines, with each line, eight letters, and the first one is supposed to be Rigveda Sara. The second line of the Gayatri Mantra is Yajurveda Sara, and the third one is Samaveda Sara, right? So these three Vedas are used in rituals, and therefore, when you chant Gayatri once, it is equal to chanting all the Vedas, right? So you can tell everyone, if you are doing the Gayatri chanting, that I'm actually chanting all the Vedas, right? So here, what does this say? Savituhu devasya tatvarenyam bargaha dhimahi varyam, right? So Savituhu devasya means what? Of the sun god, right? We are seeing Surya Bhagavan as God. So Savituhu devasya means of the sun god. Varenyam bargaha means sacred effulgence, right? So it is called the sacred effulgence because we don't look at sun as just mere light, right? But we take it as the grace of the Lord himself, and it comes from the Surya Bhagavan. Therefore, it is taken as Ishwara Anugraha. It is taken as the Prana Shakti, the energy of the world, right? It is in the highest philosophical sense, it is considered as Chaitanya Brahman. Therefore, that sacred effulgence of consciousness, Dhimahi, we meditate upon, and note the word we, Dhimahi, right? Represents Uttama Purusha Bahuvachanam. representing vayam, we, right? So many people ask, it is very important to note this. Why is it that only men are doing and not ladies, right? The idea is he is not using the singular number. He is doing it for his spouse, children, entire family, right? Extended family, the parents, all of them, right? So the wife is supposed to get the benefit of Gayatri chanting without chanting, right? So you should actually see it as an advantageous thing, right? Basically, so he refers to the children who are not yet initiated, and the spouse and parents. Maybe there are old people who cannot say also. Therefore, Dhimahi is very important to note that it is a plural number, right? So we chant for the entire world also. Loka samasta sukhino bhavantu also, right? So now let's come to Gayatri. Right, vayam savituhu devasya tatvar varenyam bargaha dhimahi, right? So we are meditating upon, and what is the phalam or what is the benefit we see? Dhiyo yona prachodayat. So may that sun god activate our intelligence, and that to the dharmic intelligence, right? Naha dhiyaha prachodayat, right? Again, naha means plural number, right? Even there, may that sun god activate the dharmic intelligence of not me and my family, but the entire society also, right? So now there are some women who want to chant the Gayatri, and therefore I remember that in the class, Swamiji actually wrote out the Smartha Gayatri for women, because a prerequisite for chanting the regular Gayatri is you should have been initiated through a thread ceremony. If women do not have that, right? I know some sects have thread ceremony, but if women have not been initiated, then there is a Smartha Gayatri also, which I thought, you know, it'll be useful to list here. You can see it, and if you want to chant, you can chant. It's also there in the PowerPoint that is going to be put up, right? So this is the Smartha Gayatri, right? So some women and girls may want to chant this, so therefore I just thought I will put this here. Then Masanam Margashirshoham, right? So among the 12 months of the year, I am Margashirshaha, that is the Margari month, which comes in December time frame, December 15th to January 15th. It is meant for all the spiritual practices to begin. That's why during that time all the temples will have pujas, right? So therefore it is considered, right, auspicious for this. It is considered inauspicious for conducting weddings and other things, but it is considered very auspicious for commencing spiritual prayers, etc., right? Ritu nam kusuma karaha. Ritu who means a season. So in the Vedic culture, 1 year is divided into 6 seasons, right? Our year starts around April 15th. Therefore, from April 15th, right, you have the first ritu as Vasanta ritu, the spring season. Second is Grishma ritu, summer. Then you have Varsha ritu, the rainy season. Then you have Sharat, which is autumn. Then you have Hemanta ritu, which is the pre-winter season. And then you have Shishira ritu, which is the actual winter, right? And Lord Krishna says, I am the Vasanta ritu, right? And Kusuma Karaha, there is an abundance of flowers during Vasanta Ritu, right? Therefore, Kusuma Karaha means Vasanta Ritu, right? So that is why Sri Krishna says here that I am the Kusuma Karaha, I am the spring among the seasons. Continuing. Dhyutam chalayatam asmi, dhyutam chalayatam asmi, tejas tejasvinamaham, tejas tejasvinamaham, jayosmi vyavasayosmi, jayosmi vyavasayosmi, satvam satvavatamaham, satvam satvavatamaham. Lord Krishna continues with the list of his vibhutis, right, which are mainly very useful for Vishwarupa Upasanam, right? That is why it is very important. In the 7th chapter, Lord Krishna pointed out that the entire creation is an expression of apara prakriti, right? So therefore Krishna now says dyutam chalayatam asmi. Basically he is trying to say the entire apara prakriti or the changing universe is so attractive that a person can get lost in any object of the world and he can miss the higher reality. In fact, apara prakriti is called mohini because it distracts us from para prakriti, right? And prakriti is what? Trigunatmika maya, right? And triguna means it has tamoguna also, and it is considered to be the most powerful one, which can delude a person by covering our discrimination through ignorance or by covering through temporary delusion. So Lord Krishna wants to point out what is the most powerful thing in the creation which can delude our mind, and even if we know what dharma is and what is adharma, temporarily suppress the wisdom. So many things are mentioned in the Bhagavatam saying that when the Kali comes, this is what will happen, right? Madhyam, starting, the list is starting with Madhyam, which is liquor, right? Bhagavatam says during the Kali, this all will happen. And the remedy for the temptation is Bhagavan Nama only, right? In Bhagavatam, it is very, very graphic, right? So here, Dyutam, Lord Krishna says, among all the tempting ones, the most powerful one is Dyutam, means all types of gambling. All types of gambling are very attractive, inclusive of the way, you know, the people who go into the stock market for short-term gains, right? That is also a form of gambling only, right? So it is so powerful that Dharmaputra himself, who is the son of Dharma Devata, the embodiment of Dharma, he himself got completely deluded. He went to such an extent that he placed his brothers and wife as stake, right? So that is why in our families, we don't allow children to even touch cards in the house, right? With or without money, we just don't allow that for this reason. So therefore, Lord Krishna says, I am the gambling game of dice, right? Dyutam means dice. So Lord Krishna mentions that dice, because Pandavas are in trouble and the war itself is in a way due to that only, right? Therefore, may you be extremely alert. In dice also, Bhagavan is there. Hence, put a namaskara and come back, right? Don't get into it. Like even in the deepest of the poison, you have Bhagavan, right? Therefore, in dice, Bhagavan is there as the tempting power, right? So, very, very important. Aham Dyutam Chalayatam Asmi. Chalayatam means among the tempting factors, among the deluding factors, I am the gambling game. Tejas Tejasvinam Aham. Tejasvinam, among those people who are brilliant, courageous and capable of confronting danger, right? The bold ones, the courageous ones, they are the rarest. So I am Tejaha, right? I am the courage in the human being, right? So in Keno Upanishad also, Bhagavan had to teach a lesson to the Devatas, who became very arrogant because of their victory over the Asuras, right? So therefore, Krishna says that this victory is not for getting arrogant. So if you are brilliant, he's trying to say that the brilliance is also because of the glory of the Lord, right? Very, very important, right? So, and jayosmi, vyavasayosmi, right? Any win, right? If you did hard work, right? The capacity to the hard work, that itself is myself, right? That hard work is also myself. Vyavasayaha means hard work, right? And sattvam sattvavatam aham. I am the sattvaguna in the sattvic people, right? Because sattvaguna also belongs to maya and maya belongs to Bhagavan. Therefore, that is also myself. Continuing. Vrishni nam vasudevosmi. Vrishni nam vasudevosmi. Pandavanam dhananjaya. Pandavanam dhananjaya. Muni nam apyaham vyasah. Muni nam apyaham vyasah. कवीनामुषणा कवि कवीनामुषणा कवि Vrishnina, among the great kings coming under the Vrishni Vamsha or Yadava Vamsha or Yadu Vamsha, right? Krishna is very smart. He says, I am Vasudevaha, means Lord Krishna himself, right? So Lord Krishna also may be thinking that he has not brought up Arjuna still. So he says, among the Pandavas, you know who I am? I am Dhananjayaha, right? I am Dhananjaya amongst the Pandavas, right? And then he also says, among the Rishis, I am Vyasacharyaha, right? So, he wants to praise Vyasacharyaha, right? Vyasa is considered to be an avatara of Lord Vishnu only. I've said this before also. Vyasaya Vishnu Rupaya Vyasa Rupaya Vishnave. So, among the Munis, I am Vyasacharya, right, who has given the Ashtadasha Purana, right? So he has given the Puranas, he has written so many Vedic books, right? Kavina Ushana, most of the scriptures, right, Vyasacharya has written. Kavina Ushana Kavihi, among the Kavis who have got farsightedness, Kranta Darshina Madhye, amongst those people, I am Shukracharya. Ushana Kavihi refers to Shukracharya, the Asura Guru. I am Shukracharya. Continuing. Dando Damayatamasmi. Dando Damayatamasmi. Niti Rasmi Jigishatam. Niti Rasmi Jigishatam. Maunam Chaivasmi Guhyanam. Maunam chaivasmi guhyanam, jnanam jnanavatamaham, jnanam jnanavatamaham. Damayatam, among the factors which discipline the human beings, all the animals are naturally disciplined. But here Krishna says, I am the dandaha, right? I am the basically the rod, right? So, Dandaha is basically rod, right? Punishment. The fear of punishment is the most powerful disciplining factor, right? So therefore Krishna says, I am Dandaha amongst the Damayatam, right? Rod of the punishers. Nitihi asmi jigishatam. Nitihi here means diplomacy, right? So for the kings, the most powerful factor is diplomacy, strategy and intelligence. We are now seeing the importance of diplomacy in the standoff also, right, between India and China. Therefore, Jigishatam, for those people, especially the rulers who want success, Sama, Dana, Beda, Danda, they say, right? Sama means what? Conciliatory process, right? This is the most powerful method of getting success. Diplomacy, dialogue and conciliation is the most effective method to, and it also can avoid violence, right? That is a very, very nice method of resolving disputes, right? So, therefore, conciliation is the best non-violent process. So, Krishna says, I am that. Then, maunam chaivasmi guhyanam. Among the secret, the greatest secret is maunam, right? Once all the secrets you can share with others, whereas once secret will be gone, right? The moment you talk, it will be gone, right? So what is that secret? Maunam. So silence is broken the moment you talk about it, right? So the silence is the greatest secret which will go away the moment you talk about, right? So from a philosophical angle, maunam represents Brahman. Brahman is called silence. I talked about it in Omkara. The silence following the Om is Brahman, right? So, greatest secret, Raja Vidya, Raja Guhyam is Brahman, the Maunam, right? And Jnanam, Jnanavatamaham, among the wise people or in the wise people, I am in the form of the very wisdom, right? So, today we will stop here and in the next class, I'll complete chapter 10 and also try and summarize chapter 10 because a lot of, in chapter 10, we've had a lot of vibhutis coming, so I can quickly summarize. So we will try and complete chapter 10 in the next week, right? Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Anybody has any questions? I'm just going to see that. Okay, I think people were happy with my samasa explanation. I was wondering whether I should do it or not. Okay. And can you please display the Smartha Gayatri, please? I will do that. And yeah, somebody has asked for access to this Viku Tusu. What you have to do is you have to go to sanskritfromhome.in and then you can register there. That's not a problem at all. And then you will have access to all the old chapters, the recordings, the PowerPoint files, the question and answers, everything. If you have a problem, please do drop us a mail, right, to sanskritfromhome.in, and we will definitely help you out. And I'm just going to show you the Smartha Gayatri also, since you asked, Geeta, just one second. Just quickly. It will be there on the site anyway. You can take a look at it. Yes. Any other questions? So, Viku, is it okay? I hope you will be able to go to the site and do it. Otherwise, do write to us. Right? And what about anybody else? Any other hands raised here? See any. Okay, no hands raised. Okay, so thank you then. Next week we will meet same time. Hari Om.